Consideration is actually one of the major component that is majorly required for any concrete. Okay, so hydration plays a very greater role. Actually, hydration is nothing but the exothermic process in the reaction between cement and water. Right? So that's the hydration. And in hydration, you have different compounds that has to be generated. Okay, so this is the name of the compounds. You can just remember the formula and abbreviated formula, so that you, just for your understanding, you can take it out. Okay, so this is actually called a box compound. Okay, so they are actually a complex compound. These are the compounds that form during the hydration of the cement. So in cement, it's not only a particular element. We are mixing different chemical components, isn't it? So each and every chemical component have their own physical and chemical properties. So that means you mix water, it will behave in a different way. So different chemical components behave in different reactions, produce different reactions, right? So this is common for any material you take. So any material you mix it with water, based upon its own physical and chemical properties, it reacts on its own way, right? So similarly, the property of cement can be changed by varying the percentage of these compounds during hydration. So as you know, so the compounds that when we varying, for example, if alumina amount is varied, or the amount of silica is varied, or different chemical components like magnesia that we are utilizing. So for each and every component, when you vary different compounds, that means the percentage, so it will give a different result. Okay, so these box compound like tricalcium silicate or dicalcium, tricalcium aluminate and tetracalcium aluminum fluoride, right? So these compounds are generally be used in commonly used cements. Okay, Portland cement that we are obtaining, whether it's a 43 grade or 53 grade or 33 grade, so these compounds are commonly formed compounds. Right? So this is all about cement. Okay, so these are the different types of cement that you can get it available in market. Okay, so we regularly use OPC, and then the recent times the rapid hardening cement is also getting more popular. Okay, and then you have air entraining cement. Air entraining cement is mostly used in pervious concrete or lightweight aggregate concrete. We are using it, right? And of course, white cement brings a greater role, especially in architectural applications, wherever you wanted to in case of any joints, you wanted to hide it, or you wanted to make any architectural grooves that you want to make. So in that way, white cement or colored cement helps us. Now, so coming to the concrete, the first and foremost step that involves in concrete is process of manufacturing. See, the manufacturing process itself requires greater knowledge and workmanship. So unless you have a very good knowledge in producing cement, and most of the properties of hardened concrete depend on the care that is exercised at every stage of the manufacture of concrete. So a rational proportioning of the ingredients of concrete is the essence of the mixed design. So that's what I already pointed out. It's just like a cooking, okay, whether you make biryani or curd rice or whatever it is, just like the right ingredients which gives it, adds flavor and taste to the food that we prepare, just like that, the right amount of mixture is essentially important in concrete. Okay, so normally when we go for a site inspection, you can see that people in some way, high or low, they will add water. Okay, and they will tell that, the contractors will usually tell that, no problem sir, during the execution we will match it. Okay, so that usually people, especially smaller firms are facing at large, because the contractor don't want to waste the concrete that he or she has mixed it. Okay, but that is eventually going to result in the poor output. Okay, so poor output definitely it will not going to make you fail or exploit the project, but still a very smaller amount of cracks or certain disintegration in the concrete can be easily witnessed. Okay, so that's why we always take care during project. When you are taking care of the project management consultancy, it is very important for you to take care of the concrete also. See, normally we have a separately for architectural consulting, structural engineering consulting, so everything is separate. Okay, so you concentrate on architectural purposes like planning, elevation and all, you people will be taking care differently, and based upon the architectural drawing, the structural engineer will take care of the beam and column design. Fine. And eventually that another party is going to execute on site. Okay, so when in any project, if these three components, okay, architecture, structure and contractor, okay, if these three components is going, is does not have any contact or less contact, definitely the output of your structure will be poor. Okay, so a proper integration between these three elements are very important. Only then a project can will have very good value. Okay, so that is very important in taking any project. Okay, so the process of manufacturing of concrete, you have a batching, mixing and transportation. Okay, batching, so this is the first step that involves gathering the ingredients necessary to produce the type of concrete it is you are required, whether it depends upon the design, M30 concrete, M25 or M30, or when you go for nuclear reactors or higher grade of concrete, M35 or M40, it depends upon the type of concrete. Okay, so for each design you require different ingredients. Okay, so the type of batching, volume or by weight is contingent on the amount of concrete being produced. Okay, so volume batching typically involved in producing smaller batches. Only for smaller batches we will go for a volume based. Okay, now due to the strenuous environment, this stage of manufacturing process requires critical care in selecting the right ingredients. Okay, so that is very important. And then mixing, so depending upon the type and quantity needed for a particular job, concrete can be mixed by hand or by stationary mixer. Okay, so in nowadays we are not depending upon the hand mixer, because a hand mixer may not guarantee a proper uniformity in mix. Okay, so even if it is smaller project, we are going for stationary mixer. Right, and for transportation we are using transit mixers or RMC lorries. Okay, so regardless of how it is mixed, the critical point is to ensure the concrete is uniform in color. When you go for inspection, you can easily point out whether it is in right consistency and whether the color is uniformity. These two is very important. Okay, and transportation and placing, methods of transporting concrete vary widely. Okay, so in somewhere some smaller sites, you can see people will take with the help of wheelbarrows. Okay, they will move, they will transport it with the help of wheelbarrows, and manual hauling to conveyor belt operations. Okay, for large site we use conveyor belts, and to more advanced projects involving cranes and pumps. Okay, so especially in larger infrastructure, high story, multi-story buildings, any tall buildings or airport project or any infrastructure based project, we actually use pumps. Okay, and all of these methods require some level of manual operation, demanding advanced safety gears as well as the right mechanical equipment. And then placing. Compaction and placing is also the next stage of the concrete manufacturing. That is also very important. Okay, so how you are going to place your concrete, because why I am stressing more on the concrete, it's not just about our lecture session which is concentrate on concrete, but also in India especially, when you are going to practice your architectural or structural engineering profession, so it is mandatory that you should have certain knowledge on concrete, because concrete is a versatile material that we are using everywhere. Okay, so concrete is become a predominant part of our career. So whether you are an architect or you are a structural engineer, so a concentration or a very good knowledge on concrete will definitely make you or enhance your career. Okay, that's why I'm stressing more on this basics of concrete. Okay. So during mixing and transport, air is often entrapped in concrete, greatly reduces the quality and strength. Okay, so that is another important point that we have to consider. So one of the final stages of production involves compacting the product to eliminate the air pockets and ensure durability. And that's why if you observe in the ready-mix concrete, when you transport the concrete, the mix, the lorry will, the transit mixer, it always keep rotating. So the first point is it is preventing the hardening or preventing the hardening initiation of concrete, as well as it resolves or dissolves the air entrapped in it. Okay, and so that's the main thing. And for compaction, we use mostly, if you see in the small set, we use hand compaction, and even very small contractors are nowadays, they start using the vibrators. Okay, so the vibrators and that also gives you more uniformity. Okay, so what happens is when you are not concentrating very well on compaction, you can see after removing the formwork, the honeycomb will be there. Okay, you can see the aggregates will be get into in a very particular location. You can see, especially in columns, we have this problem because we will pour a large amount of concrete volume into it. Okay, and then finally the contractor will get into compaction or vibrating. Okay, in that scenario, what happens is we will depends upon the height of the vibrator that we are using. We will first pour the concrete to one level, we will vibrate it or compact it, and then again we'll pour into next level and we'll. So in this way, we are going to make the compaction work very well, at the same time preventing the honeycomb. So the major point is, people will on site, especially in a smaller residential project, even now we are facing. Okay, even 2 months back in one of the sites, we observed the same thing, especially in the columns, because they mix all the concrete and they completely pour it into the column, and because only the top layer they could able to compact it very well, and the bottom, right, that particular bottom for 1 foot, the honeycomb was witnessed. Okay, that's because of the poor management on site as well as poor compaction. And in fact, the concrete does not gain strength by drying out, of course. So what you need to add water to that, so that's called curing. So curing is very important. So why curing is important? These are the two major factors that you can observe. So concrete does not gain strength by drying. Concrete must have continuous free access to water to achieve its ultimate strength. That's why the curing of concrete is always given a greater importance. Okay. So the curing of concrete, actually the process of keeping concrete wet by different methods. We use different methods, right? Sometimes you can see people use sack bags or gunny bags that are being tied to the columns, and they will keep it wet. And the most common method that we are using is a pond. Okay, so by means of pond, we are pour water on slab and we will do it. So the objective of curing is to prevent loss of moisture from concrete due to evaporation or because of any other reason. Especially, as I said, the hydration plays a greater role. Okay, so during hydration, it requires more water. Otherwise, early stage of cracking is possible. That's why when you undertake any projects, don't compromise on curing. Okay, so that is going to result in a greater level of shrinkage cracks that is going to occur at the earliest stage. Okay, so that is very important. For curing of concrete, the surface of concrete is sometimes we used to coat a different layer of bitumen, but that's going to take more workmanship or skilled labor, and that's why we don't focus much on that. Instead, we are using a very easiest method like compaction. Ponding or sprinkling, fogging, and wet coverings like using of gunny bags and all. So that in that way we are using curing of concrete. So this is how we use go for sprinklers. And sometimes you can see that sheets, right? That sheets will be made up of fibrous sheets, and they will put it up. Okay, so they will sprinkle water and cover it. Okay, so the water, the further evaporation of water will be prevented. In somewhere we use bituminous sheets also, but as I said, for larger projects where the rate of progress should be higher, so in that way we are not going to spend much of time in this method. Okay, so again the bituminous layer we are using. Okay, so this is mostly used in industrial applications where the large amount of floor area, say for example 10,000 square feet or 20,000 square feet of area is going to be concrete flooring. In that scenario we'll be using. Okay, so here you can see there is a banding. Okay, so here the banding is here, right? So in this banding you can see this is actually a private terrace and top of it is a common terrace. Okay, so here they see they have fixed a pipe. So this pipe is obviously going to affect during the rainy season the people who are in a terrace. Okay, so you may have a question how it going to affect, because in private terrace also it's going to rain. Okay, but in future, the owner of this particular apartment can have a roof or a temporary structure with the sheets. Okay, so you wanted to make a truss and fit it with a fibrous sheet. In that scenario, definitely this is going to spoil the project value. And again, you can see when we already given a clear instruction to the contractor that no bandings or no plumbing fixtures should be given exactly on the line of banding. You can see the cement banding, right? So here the pipe is exactly fixed on top of the banding. Okay, so this is going need to be avoided, because that is definitely going to damage your banding through water penetration as well as through shrinkage cracks. So this kind of things especially should be avoided. Okay, and here if you observe, you can see the grooves in the parapet wall. You can see grooves, right? So this is also in most of the building contractors are leaving out. Okay, so that should not be the case, especially when your structure or wall is exposed to the outer atmospheric conditions. Okay, means inner wall you need not too much worry about it. Okay, whereas the external wall, so especially for the larger span, larger walls, or even if it is smaller wall, you can see here this one, this parapet wall, right? So here in this scenario you can provide this kind of grooves, because that is definitely going to help you give a very good value to your project, because the plastering work that we are using, right, that plastering is going to produce more air cracks. Okay, so that has to be avoided by provisioning of such grooves. Okay, so the mortar that you are using for this plastering should also be well mixed. Okay, so that is also very important, and these grooves are largely helpful in reducing any of the air cracks or shrinkage cracks that are especially visible in the structural elements that are highly exposed to the outer atmosphere. And again, another point where people will mostly fail or does not take much more detail on it is, see here, this is the top of So this is on top of this window frame, is a slab of concrete. Okay, so this is exactly lies in the junction of your slab, or you can say the loft. Okay, so loft is obviously a concrete material, and see, this is also another, at least you should leave a 1-inch gap, will be a good one. Otherwise, what happens is, this exactly, if you are fixing on it, definitely it will develop the crack, because when you load the saw, the loft, that, okay, so based upon the, based upon the loading as well as the different material, okay, so that is definitely going to observe. Normally, we do not prefer such a method. We either prefer, at least one brick gap is required. So on top of it, one brick gap, when you are putting up, you are going to put a lintel to that. Okay, so that is very important. Okay, so here, this kind of things directly sort of different properties of concrete. So I just taken out very few properties that you can actually check on site, and we will discuss about those properties. Okay, for example, you take workability. So the name itself is self-explanatory, right? It's not so much of technical content. So just workability, the ability to do the right work. So what is the right work of a concrete? So it should be filled everywhere the shape that you have put up. So for a slab, whether it may be a rectangular slab, okay, so or any type of shape that you prefer, okay. So for that slab, it has to fill everywhere, and it has to harden properly and uniformly. Okay, so a concrete mix that satisfies these conditions should be called as workable. Okay, so it is actually a property of raw or fresh concrete mixture. In simple words, workability means the ease of placement, and workable concrete means the concrete which can be placed and can be compacted easily without any segregation. So without segregation, what is segregation? The aggregates that you are using, right, that should not be, when you put it out, so it shouldn't be separated. So again, you take any food also, when you pour from one vessel to another vessel, so it's not gets it separate, fine. So similarly, the concrete, when you pour it, it should be acting as a, although it is heterogeneous, it should behave like a homogeneous as a single material. So that is the workability of a concrete. Actually, this is a vital property of concrete and related with compaction as well as strength. So workability needs to be considered a lot. So workability of concrete, you have the right amount of work required to place concrete and to compact it thoroughly. Okay, so the use of aggregates, and so these are the ways in which we achieve the workability of a concrete in a right way. So for example, the methods that we actually follow to improve the workability on site is increasing water cement ratio, the ratio between the water and the cement that we are using, using of larger aggregates, and well rounded and smooth aggregate, instead of if you take aggregate or stone that you are using, right, instead of very sharp, just when you have a blunt, okay, well rounded, okay, so that smoothness is going to give you a very good binding between the different materials. So increasing the mixing time and the temperature is also going to help us. Okay, so using non-porous and saturated aggregates, or using appropriate admixtures required for a specific purpose of the concrete that you are using. So that is also the way in which we increase the workability of concrete. So the next is consistency. So what is consistency? Again, since you can easily remember, I can point you with the right example of food. Okay, so you can take again a curd rice. Okay, when you mix it with, it should have a right consistency, fine. So it should not be much solid, or it should not be much liquid as well. Okay, it should be quite semi-solid shape. So that's how you can make a good presentation. So especially when serving in restaurant, so they do it in the right consistency. So that's very important. Likewise, concrete, you are using different ingredients. So those different ingredients is a matter of concern when you make a right concrete. Because consistency is the relative mobility or ability of fresh mixed concrete to flow. It includes the entire range of fluidity from the driest to the wettest possible mixes. Consistency and workability are often confused with one another. Workability means ease with which concrete can be moved and placed without segregation. Whereas consistency, on the other hand, is degree of wetness of concrete. So how wet your concrete is, it should not be having so much of water, or it should not be having a lesser degree of wetness, that means very lower water. So that's going to spoil your consistency again. Okay, so that means how wet the concrete is, that degree. So slump test, so this is one of the easiest and the portable method we follow on site. So the slump that you are seeing, right? The value of concrete is just a principle of gravity flow of surface of the concrete. So that's the cone in the picture. You can see they have a fabricated cone. In that cone we will actually, the cone that you are seeing, right, it's in a reversible form. Okay, so it should be reversed and we will pour concrete. Okay, so why in this picture we reverse it? Because so we reverse it so that it exactly fits with this slump. And now this is the measurement. So these measurements give in this picture in the left, you can see the concrete is quite stable. That means the consistency is quite good. Okay, so here you can see that with the help of this slump, you can see we are measuring the top. Okay. Whereas to the right, you can see the concrete is having or not having a very good condition of compaction or consistency. Okay, so that's why this is happening. Okay. So this is what the slump test, especially where you can use this slump test is, suppose for your project, you are procuring your RMC, the ready mix concrete, from another third party. So when this RMC comes to your site, and before pouring of concrete on the formwork that we have fabricated, so you can go for testing of the slump and you can decide how consistency the concrete mix is preferred. So that is where this test comes into picture. So here you can see, right? So this one, so these things is what resembles of your concrete. So the layer one, see, this is what I told you. So you require this require good compaction. Okay, you cannot pour the entire concrete like this. In the third picture, you cannot pour entire concrete and you can go for compaction. Instead, the layered compaction is very important, not only for this slump test, for the entire concrete project that you are using. Whether you are going for a column, so especially in column we are facing this, and again in the shear walls or in the retaining walls we will be facing this. So when you put the concrete to a certain layer and then you compact it, right, after the compaction you again pour another layer, that is stage 2. Then in the stage 3 you can again fix it. Okay, so after this you are getting these different shapes. So you have true slump, shear slump and collapse slump. So for any large construction project, a slump test is very useful to check day to day or even hour to hour variation of the quality of concrete mix. And by observing the slump reading, this is whether true slump, shear slump or collapse slump. So by observing the reading, we can easily change the moisture content and grading of concrete. So due to that reason, it is the most common method of test. So true slump. True shape of a slump is only a verified slump. This slump This shape is measured as the difference between the top layer of the cone to the top of your slump concrete, right? So collapsed concrete. So it shows that due to high water cement ratio, the shape of a slump is not a clear dimension. So it means that, okay, the third one I am talking about, it means that the concrete is very high workability for which slump test is not suitable, very high. Okay. So whereas in the shear slump, this shape of slump is same as shear failure of the soil layers. Just like that, in what it represents, same representation. So this is an indication of lack of cohesion of concrete mix ingredients. So this should be avoided, and your fresh sample has to be taken. So when your project, in your project, if your concrete is having a true slump, you can very well go ahead with your concrete mix. Out of which, if you are observing or you are getting shear slump or collapse slump way, then you have to change accordingly. Another important point is segregation. So segregation actually refers to segregation of the elements that when you are putting up in the concrete. Okay, so that's why when you are placing the materials that we are replacing in the concrete, especially the coarse aggregate that we are using, it should not be get separated. So that consistency follows the segregation, right? So the factors influencing it, actually the water cement ratio, the poor water cement ratio is going to affect, and the quality of coarse aggregate and fine aggregate, the shape, moisture content, texture, grading, everything is very important. That's why I told you the material, from the stage of material procurement, you have to ensure the quality of the materials. Only then you can get a very good quality of concrete. Else, what you are seeing in the right side, that kind of honeycombness is going to be observed in your project. So that is again a major thing. And in the left side, it is quite good and not as bad as what you are seeing in the right side, but still here the texture is not good. Okay, the void ratio of concrete and air content of concrete also plays a greater role, and that is going to result in poor texture. So the time of test after mixing of concrete. So once you mix all the materials and you make the concrete, fine, good. So now you should not delay your placement of concrete. So as soon as your concrete is ready, you have to take it for the placement and you have to complete the placement fully. And that's why in most of the project, if you see, they will go for concreting the slab. So the site engineer will be observing that it might be rain. So they will definitely not stop the concreting intermediately. So it has to be at any cost, you have to completely fill the concrete. So otherwise it is going to give the difference or variation in your texture or even in the strength. That is also possible. So segregation. The segregation, some of the factors that affects the segregation. Okay, so the large maximum particles and proportion of larger particles. Okay, so that is also another greater thing. So segregation of concrete is the separation of cement paste and aggregates of concrete from each other during handling and placement. Segregation also occurs due to, see, again, the name itself is quite self-explanatory, segregating, right? So separation. Separation of what materials that you are using into the concrete. And remember, segregation also occurs due to over vibration or compaction of concrete. Over vibration is also going to separate the material. So that is also should be taken care. In a good concrete, all concrete aggregates are evenly coated with sand, cement paste, and form a homogeneous mass. So during handling, transporting, and placing, due to the jerks and vibration, the paste of the cement and sand gets separated from the coarse aggregate. So if concrete segregate during transit, it should be remixed properly before depositing. So that's why the transit, this also you can observe, this is commonly being practiced on site. So when the RMC lorry comes for delivery of the concrete. So when we are pouring, before pouring, we can see the concrete, the speed of the transit will be increased. So it will rotate at a high speed for some 20 to 30 seconds, and then it will be stopped, and then it will be poured. So that is the reason of it. Okay, so it should be remixed properly before depositing. Bleeding is again one of the yet another greatest problem that we are facing in concrete, especially with the contractors who are not much concentrating or giving detailing on mixing of water. So right amount of water is very important. So this bleeding, right, it is in fresh concrete refers to the process where free water in the mix, the concrete mix, is pushed upward to the surface due to the settlement of heavier solid particles such as cement and water. Some bleeding is normal, but excessive bleeding can be definitely a problematic. Okay, so the way you work, that bleed water can affect the durability of products. So bleeding directly have a link with durability of your building. Okay, so you are planning that your structure should be at least safely stand for 99 years. So when you have a larger bleeding in a structure, then that is not going to be possible. So take care of the bleeding when you are going for any site inspection. So bleeding of the water continues until the cement paste has stiffened enough to end the sedimentation process. So cement types also are actually the different types of cement that you are using, right? That also going to influence bleeding capacity. Increased proportions of, for example, we use one type of material called ground granulated glass furnace slag. So in short, we call it as GGBS. So this, when the cement combination containing that GGBS, leading to an increase in the time for bleeding continue due to a longer setting time. Okay, so when you are using different types of cement for your concreting applications, right amount of chemical admixtures or super plasticizer has to be utilized, else it is going to result in such kind of bleeding. Fine. So this is a typical representation of ready mix concrete plant. Okay, so you will be storing all the aggregates in the silos, then it will be transferred to the mix area with the help of conveyor belts, and then finally it comes into the transit mixture. Okay. So what are the different types of concrete we have used? We use lean concrete. Apart from the modern types, the conventional types are lean cement concrete, plain cement, reinforced and pre-stressed cement concrete, where we use grades higher than M35. So this is commonly utilized one. Okay, so M10 normally used for foundations, M15 for slabs and beams, and again that also we have stopped, and we started utilizing M20 as a minimal grade of any projects. So M25 can also be preferred. So when you go for infrastructure based project, you can go ahead with M30, 35, and power plants or nuclear power plants, we use M40. Okay. So uses of concrete, actually again, I hope concrete, as I said, it's a versatile material, and among all the construction materials used in the world, concrete is most widely used due to its unique benefits compared to other materials. So concrete is actually quite economical when compared to various other types of materials. Okay, so concrete hardens at ambient temperature, so it is versatile and have the ability to cast into different shape that you want. You want circular, you can cast it. You want rectangular, triangular, pentagon, whatever the shape you require, so you can go ahead with it. So it have excellent water resistance characteristics, high temperature resistance, and application in reinforced concrete is very vast, and low maintenance is also one of the greatest uses of concrete. So